So the topic for today's talk is warnings from the heart, the do's and don'ts. Actually, whoever gave this topic, I think we should appreciate them, because generally people tend to talk about prevention, and we have been giving repeated talks about prevention, and I am sure in your respective companies there have been a lot of people who told you what to eat, what not to eat, what to exercise and what not to exercise. But very rarely do we say, we talk about the issues when the patient is suspected to have a cardiac issue, what should we do? So let's see whether this talk is actually important or not. I'll just start with a case. This was a 45-year-old male, and he had some retrosternal burning. He thought it was gas, but one of his family friends was a pulmonologist. So he went to the pulmonologist, and the pulmonologist said, no need to worry, you please go home. The patient, of course, insisted that he wanted to take a ECG, because somehow this looks something different and he is not comfortable going back home. He went down, this was in the sixth floor, then he went to the ground floor. The technician who did the ECG told him, something is abnormal in the ECG, don't move and I'll inform the doctor. Unfortunately for him, the pulmonologist was upset on the technician. He said, what do you know? Are you a doctor or I am a doctor? And told the patient that the technician has no sense. You come climbing up stairs to the sixth floor, and that will prove that you are fine and I'll send you home. So this poor guy with retrosternal burning and an abnormal ECG started climbing the stairs. He had a cardiac arrest and collapsed on the third floor. So I am not starting my presentation on a pessimistic note. This patient actually was revived, and then we took him up for a primary angioplasty. One of his vessels called LAD was occluded, a stent was placed, and luckily the patient came out of all these things and went back home, and he is still alive and kicking and doing quite well. But what is the important learning in this particular example? The important learning here is, if you have retrosternal burning, do not experiment and exert to see if it is cardiac. Lot of people come to us and then say that they had some uneasiness, and then they wanted to check whether it is cardiac or not, so they started climbing up the stairs, only to realize that something which was probably unstable angina, that's a warning, got converted into a heart attack, which we call as myocardial infarction. So before we go into further details of this talk, I thought we'll just look at certain common terms. These are questions which people quite often ask to understand what the difference between these terms are. A commonly used term is angina or ischemia. Then some people say they had an attack, a heart attack or a brain attack. Some people mention it's a cardiac arrest. Some people mention that it's heart failure. So what is the difference between all these? So if you look at, if you just see this video, this is your heart, and this is a large vessel called aorta, which gives blood to the heart, and there are small coronary vessels which come from this aorta and then supply the muscle of the heart. So the vessels which supply your heart are actually above the heart. Now if you look at the cut section of the vessel, they are generally smooth and the blood flows in a smooth manner. Slowly, as fat gets deposited here, either cholesterol or fibrosis, you can see that there is narrowing of the vessel. Now when narrowing of the vessel occurs in a normal situation, that means when you are at rest, the blood supply might be sufficient for you. But as you start exerting, when the heart rate increases, or you have taken heavy meals, or there is an emotional stress, this amount of blood which is getting supplied to your heart is not sufficient. And this is the time when you start experiencing what we call as angina, or in the medical terms it's called as ischemia, that is decreased blood supply to the heart. But still the heart muscle has not got damaged. So there is decreased blood supply, but the heart muscle has not got damaged. When does it get converted into heart attack? If there is some situation because of which there is a sudden rupture of this plaque. So this is a cholesterol plaque, and then when there is a rupture here, the fat comes into the blood and all the platelets and clotting factors come and get clotted here and completely stop the blood supply of that vessel. That is, it is a 100% occlusion. So that ischemia or angina is a kind of warning signal, and then when it gets completely blocked, you develop a heart attack, which actually causes a damage to the heart. So the idea here is to prevent that heart attack from occurring. And in case the heart attack occurs, you try to reach the hospital as early as possible. Now, what about cardiac arrest? If you look at cardiac arrest, it's basically that a person has just collapsed beside you. So a simple thing is, he's non-responsive or he has some kind of agonal breathing, some kind of a snoring kind of thing. And the survival of this patient actually depends upon the bystander. So you should know certain basic things. We have different courses which go on, the basic life support, advanced life support courses. Important thing is to call for help, ask somebody to just call the emergency, the ambulance, and immediately start cardiac massage. Many times previously, people used to be worried to do CPR, what we call cardiopulmonary resuscitation, with the fear that they have to do mouth-to-mouth breathing. Nowadays, we have confirmed evidence that even if you don't do mouth-to-mouth breathing, if you just do the cardiac massage, that is sufficient enough to cause enough movement of the chest, which can also cause enough oxygenation. So at least start cardiac massage. This is not going to be dangerous to you. In case you feel that this patient actually was not in cardiac arrest, even in that circumstance, if you are going to do this cardiac massage, it's not going to harm the patient. But your fear of unknown or stopping because thinking that this patient is probably not in cardiac arrest can actually do damage, because your brain is going to get completely damaged in the next 3 minutes. So you have to react in that first 3 minutes to make sure that this patient at least reaches the hospital and is alive to tell a story the next day. Right? So you do the cardiac massage. It's very simple. Just lock both your fingers. Make sure that the elbow is straight, and then start the cardiac massage. At if you have information about AED, which is the automated defibrillator, if it is there in your office or if it's there nearby, get it. This is one of the life-saving equipment. You don't have to do anything. The AED will tell you what to do. You just follow the instructions and then you should be good to go. So that is a cardiac arrest. That means the patient has collapsed. That is what we mean by cardiac arrest. It's not a heart attack. Heart attack can lead to cardiac arrest, but both are not the same. The final term which is used is what we call as heart failure. Now, heart failure basically means it's a clinical diagnosis. That means you have swelling of feet, the patient has breathlessness on exertion, the patient gets up in the night with breathlessness, patient has cough while lying down, patient might have a distension of the abdomen because there is fluid there. Any of these things indicate heart failure. Fundamentally, what is happening here, if this is the normal heart, the left ventricle, this is the left side of the heart, this is the right side. The left side of the heart becomes grossly dilated, and the function of the heart, so the muscle which normally contracts, is now become extremely weak and is not contracting the way it is supposed to contract. So that is typically the heart failure which we come across. Now, what are the symptoms of heart problem which we need to look at? The commonest is chest pain. The patient might present to you. You might have breathlessness, which might indicate a cardiac issue. You might have palpitations. Palpitations is basically the heart is beating extremely fast, or you feel missed beats, or you feel that the heart is beating extremely slow. The swelling of the feet, which is common. Many times it's quite easy to identify that the legs are swollen, and any faint. So patient was all right and suddenly he passed out. In those situations, you should suspect if there is any underlying cardiac issue. At least you need to rule out that particular cardiac issue. So this is a chart to again explain those particular symptoms. So if you look at, you can have a uneasiness, you can have some kind of a vomiting. The problem is with retrosternal burning, where you might mistake it for a cardiac issue. You might have an unusual shortness of breath, you might have vomitings, you might feel extreme weakness. So multiple symptoms can be there which could indicate an underlying cardiac issue. Now, why do we need to discuss all these issues? So there are certain challenges in recognizing heart symptoms. Now, when you have a retrosternal pain, we commonly tell our students that one of the issues which happened with the movies, whether it is Hindi movies or Telugu movies, is you'll always find that a person who has a heart attack, he is typically shown as somebody who has developed a pain at the left side in the corner of the heart. That's actually not right. Most of the patients who develop the pain, they develop behind the breastbone. So they develop that uneasiness or some kind of a vague sensation or burning sensation, which can very easily be mistaken for an acid reflux disease. So that actually prevents the person from seeking medical attention. They tend to take some antacids and then stay back home, only to later realize that they had a major attack. So it's commonly confused with a gastric problem. Now remember that when in doubt, always treat it as cardiac. If suppose 9 out of 10 times it was a gastric problem, but you treated it as cardiac, it's not going to make a major difference. But that one time when it was cardiac, you thought it was gastric, then it could make a difference between life and death to the patient. So when in doubt, always treat it as if it is a cardiac issue. Proactively rule out a cardiac issue and then evaluate for the gastric issues. Now the other challenge is in diabetics. So diabetics have what is called as a silent ischemia. That means you might have had a heart attack, but still they don't have any chest pain, they don't have any breathlessness, they don't have any palpitations. There may not be any symptoms, and incidentally you take a ECG or you do an echocardiogram and then you realize that this patient probably had a myocardial infarction or a ischemia or a heart attack previously. So this is a danger which diabetics face, because the nerve endings in the heart, they are generally damaged, so they don't feel the same type of pain which non-diabetics feel. The other issue is about referred pain. That means the pain doesn't occur at the place where it has originated, so it doesn't occur in the heart, but it could occur at multiple different places. So what are these places? We said it could be behind the breastbone, it could be on the chest, in the center of the chest, radiating to the jaw. So this is common, people feeling tightness in the jaw. The pain could radiate to the left shoulder. The pain could be just in the epigastrium, exactly simulating a gastric problem. It could be in all these places. So it could be jaw, both the shoulders, both left hand, right hand. It could be on both the sides. It could be just on the neck, or it could be sometimes in the back. So these are all called referred pain. So why does this referred pain occurs? So commonly what happens is we have what is called as the somatic supply and visceral. Somatic means it's from the skin. So from the time you were born, continuously there has been some stimulation to your hand, to your shoulder, to your neck, or you had some injury, and the brain is tuned to understand that there is some impulse which is coming from any of these parts. Now for the first time, when the same nerve supply, the pain comes from the heart, the brain is not tuned to getting pain from the heart. So it thinks it's actually coming from the hand or it's coming from the jaw. So it mistakes it and it refers the pain there. So you feel as if the pain is in the hand. The brain feels the pain is in the hand when actually the pain is originating from the heart. So that is called as referred pain. You will be surprised to know there have been instances where patients have had a dental extraction done. So patient had acute heart attack, had severe pain in one of the tooth. They went to the dentist, they removed the tooth, then realized that the pain did not subside. So incidentally, some physician told that you take a ECG. When the ECG was taken, they realized that there was a massive heart attack which was going on, and then he was admitted in the hospital and some angioplasty was done. Now many of us might think that okay, he's talking too much about differentiation between a gastric problem and a cardiac problem. At least if we go to a cardiologist, we go to a physician, they'll be able to differentiate whether it is cardiac or whether it is gastric. I'll give you an example. I am talking about a cardiologist, a world-renowned cardiologist, who actually retired as head of department in the Department of Cardiology in one of the premier institutes in this country in New Delhi. Okay, so he was such a famous guy. When he had uneasiness in the chest while he was going for a talk in Singapore, and he was carrying his luggage in the airport, he had uneasiness in the chest. He thought that it is gastric. He thought it is gastric. He took antacids. He came back to Mumbai. Again in Mumbai airport, he again had that uneasiness. He still was not convinced that it is cardiac. Then he landed in Hyderabad. Somehow he felt, I keep teaching to everyone that we should not, it's difficult to differentiate cardiac and gastric. Why not take a ECG? And luckily he took a ECG and he was in that unstable angina. That means he had not yet developed the heart attack. And he immediately rushed to the hospital and had an angiogram done. He had a severe triple vessel disease, and then he had to undergo a bypass surgery done. So this is a cardiologist who taught students the difference between cardiac and gastric issues for close to 30 years, and he had difficulty when he had that uneasiness. So be aware that when you have these type of symptoms, it is better to be safe rather than sorry. So let's look at the do's and don'ts when you have these type of warning signs which we just discussed. Immediately seek attention. try to call up the emergency ambulance of some hospital and try to go to the hospital in ambulance. Use sorbitrate. So this is isosorbide dinitrate. So this is a small tablet. You can take half tablet of this below your tongue, which causes dilatation of the vessel and prevents that warning from going into an attack. Remember that when you put this drug below your tongue, it can cause fall in blood pressure. So try to be in a sitting position or in a lying down position when you take that. Don't be in a standing position. You might suddenly have giddiness and you might pass out. Take aspirin chewable. So you get chewable aspirin tablets. The idea is immediately aspirin will prevent that blood from clotting, and at least till you reach the hospital, it might prevent a heart attack from progressing to a full-fledged level. Loosen the clothing. That can make you feel more comfortable. It doesn't have any medical reason, but at least you will feel comfortable when you are sweating, when you are having a heart attack. Try to go to the hospital in ambulance, unless there is no other way. Always remember that ambulance will allow you to reach the hospital much faster than your own vehicle, and never ever take public transport in these type of situations. If there is a cardiac arrest, immediately start CPR. So this is for people who are bystander. Immediately start cardiac massage. Don't think about anything. Don't think whether you are doing it right, wrong, whether is it the right way of doing it, or you are right in doing it. When in doubt, start cardiac massage. Nothing is going to happen. You are not going to harm the patient if you start cardiac arrest. Please do not exert. We started with that example. Do not experiment with yourself. There is nowhere in the literature it is written that if you have a doubt whether it is cardiac or not, you exert yourself and try to check if it is cardiac. You can kill yourself. Kindly do not exert. Do not smoke. So people might laugh, why will somebody smoke when they are having a heart attack? So people feel a sense of anxiety. They'll feel, okay, let me smoke and see whether I'll feel more comfortable. Do not do it. Even one cigarette can kill you. Do not give food. Again, some of our grandparents, they will say, okay, he's having sweating and all, first let's start feeding him. That's again wrong, because when you feed somebody, you are pushing the blood supply to the intestine, and the blood supply to the heart comes down even further. Do not postpone medical attention. Night 1 o'clock, okay, why disturb anyone? Tomorrow morning 6 o'clock, let me find out if I can go to the hospital. Heart attack doesn't wait for day, night, transport, nothing. Whatever time of day or night, you have to rush to the hospital. Do not wait for next day morning. You might just sleep and not get up the next day morning. So these are serious issues. We are talking from examples, real life examples, which have happened in front of our eyes. And do not refuse admission when advised. So many people do Google search and they think they are doctors. And when some cardiologist tells them that it's better you stay back in the night, and at least tomorrow morning let us observe, they'll say, no, corporate hospitals probably want to make some money, so that's why they are admitting. It's not so. These are all very unpredictable issues. Actually, we had one of our very enterprising cardiologists who, there was a patient who went to 3 cardiologists and said that he was having gas. So finally he came to the 4th cardiologist and he said, Dr. Saab, abhi bhi gas bharawa hai, ECG theek hai saab, gas bharawa hai, ECG is clearly showing MI. So then the cardiologist told him that agar ye gas hai to aap bhi phukke ke maafik upar chale jayenge. So after some time this gas will take you to your heavenly abode, so better get admitted and get treated. So kindly do not refuse admission. If there's a doctor, he is telling you to get admitted, it is for your own good, not to just make some money over your heart for that particular night. And do not ignore symptoms, because ECG and blood test is normal. So most important is symptoms. Your uneasiness, that discomfort is most important. ECG can be absolutely normal. Blood test, which is called troponin, is commonly done. That can be absolutely normal. That doesn't mean anything. If the symptoms are suggestive, you should still always make sure that you get proper treatment. Start those injections. Not that you should get immediately angiogram done, but start those injections, because you are one step before that heart attack. So the idea is to prevent that heart attack, and then you can always look at how to treat later. Now commonly you will have on WhatsApp excellent videos which will say there is a fast way to stop a heart attack. You cough, you do this, that. There is no way to stop a heart attack other than taking sorbitrate, aspirin, and reaching the hospital as soon as possible and taking a proper treatment. So there is no fast way to stop a heart attack without seeking emergency medical attention. Online you will find many fast heart attack treatments. However, these fast treatments are not effective and could be dangerous because you are delaying the emergency treatment. So, ladies and gentlemen, summarizing, remember that symptoms of heart disease can at times be subtle. Be careful about it. Recognizing the symptoms helps in seeking early medical attention and prevent irreversible damage. Once the heart muscle is damaged, there is no way that you can get it back. Many times it may be almost impossible to differentiate gastric from cardiac issues. Cardiac arrest needs immediate attention, and prevention of heart disease is the best strategy to prevent morbidity and mortality. Probably some other time we'll talk about prevention of heart disease. So be happy, be safe, and thank you very much for listening to this talk.